appreciate everyone joining us today. It is my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Mr. Robert Dale Jackson. As Executive Director of Natural Resources and Environmental Science for the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma's Legal and Compliance Division, Mr. Jackson works on strengthening tribal sovereignty and ensuring environmental regulatory monitoring and compliance. He develops sustainable practices for land asset management. And here's my favorite Dale story. You didn't know this was coming, but to me, this was such a learning moment for us. We were at a large meeting exploring opportunities for OSU to work with the Choctaw Nation. And the question, it was a great question, was asked, so Mr. Jackson, help me understand, are your programs aimed at serving the Choctaw Nation or as serving the citizens of the Choctaw Nation who might be involved in farming and ranching? And guess what he said? Yes. I thought, oh, tribal sovereignty. So you've got tribal enterprise, and you've got citizens that participate as part of that enterprise and also participate in their own right. So he is an incredible leader, a friend of the center, a friend to many here, and it's my extreme pleasure to introduce Mr. Dale Jackson.
Thank you, and she's too kind, but you all already know that. My pleasure to be here today, and kind of caught off guard a little bit when Elizabeth asked me to speak because I've moved around in departments some at the Nation and tried to do what leadership has asked from forming programs and developing existing programs. And we've had a lot of great success over the last few years, and I'm very happy with the way things are going. We still have a lot of work to do, obviously, and I would say that most tribal nations in Oklahoma probably feel the same way about a lot of their internal programs. With all the changes that federal government and the state government and financial woes and things of that nature, there's a lot of sleepless nights, and the job never continues, especially in my new role with environmental compliance and a few other aspects of what we do with water management and things along that line. So, but today I'm here to talk about sovereignty, and originally it was around agriculture, and I asked her if I could focus more on natural resources. She agreed, and I will hit some sustainable agriculture comments. I'm trying not to put anybody to sleep. I know everybody came for the box lunch and not really to hear me, so I have about 15 slides, and I'm going to try to go through and have some comments that I'll make, and I have a video to watch that relates to the water settlement that happened earlier, or last year actually now. If you're not familiar with that, we'll talk a little bit about it and some of the pieces of how sovereignty played a gigantic role in the long, arduous task of resolving water regulation in Oklahoma, and continues now. Obviously, that job is never done as well. So as I mentioned, I'm going to roll right into it and talk about what is sovereignty. And as most people know, it's the right to self-govern, right? And from a tribal perspective, we see things a little differently because of the nature of our inherent sovereignty related to pre-colonial times, right? So everyone knows that tribes are sovereign because the recognition of being sovereign from European explorers were treaties. Well, you don't do treaties with other non-existing sovereigns. We do treaties nation to nation. So from the beginning of time or beginning of existence and acknowledgement of tribes, they have been sovereign. Obviously, we understand in the United States, in its current state, it's a little different. It's kind of like, do we have any economics folks in the room? It's not always yes and no. There's a lot of maybes, right? So sovereignty kind of is that way now. Unfortunately, it's not absolute, it's not clear. A lot of times it is maybe, related to regulatory compliance, related to jurisdictional pieces. There's a lot of maybes. We do know a few things. We know that the United States of America, as a entity, is a sovereign entity, right? And then the United States, it considers itself the supreme sovereign entity. And it felt so compelled to put that on paper to make us all believe it, right? So. We have the Constitution, and that lines out a lot of what sovereignty is as it belongs to the United States and state and tribal governments. we recognize that here in the United States, that the states themselves have some self-governing components, and pre-Civil War, there was even the mindset of, even though we had a constitution, that the states were sovereign, right? And that's what actually resulted in the Civil Wars, the fight for states' rights. So, you know, there's a lot of conversation over the years, and I'll go into some of those as we come through this, about what is sovereignty, what can it be, what isn't it, what do you want it to be, what do we want it to be, and so on and so forth. So tribal sovereignty, obviously, comes back around to self-governance, and there's a lot of conversations and catchphrases that are thrown out, and sovereign immunity and self-governance and 638 with federal government and things along those lines. But it boils down to one thing. It's our right to govern ourselves within the United States as tribal nations. Obviously, I broke out there the absolute sovereignty, pre-colonial. You know, we didn't have anyone interfering with our sovereignty. There may have been warring factions or disagreements between tribes, but tribes managed themselves. They governed themselves. They had a system of government, and it existed. And then, of course, we get into the legal end of things where there's the institutionally recognized sovereignty, which is kind of what we deal with today, and then, of course, de facto sovereignty. What does it really exist? What level of control really exists at each level of self-governance? So most of you, if you're familiar with sovereignty, you're very familiar with the Marshall Trilogy, and in there, the Supreme Court dimed the phrase domestic dependent nations for tribes. And that's how the federal government sees tribal entities. But the beauty of domestic dependent nations is that the way that they define it, it doesn't just limit the sovereignty of tribes, but it also limits the sovereignty of the federal government and state governments, and each are limited by each other. So kind of a checks and balance of sorts. So where does tribal sovereignty come from, and where did it go? As I mentioned, we talked about treaties. Obviously, we know that you don't do treaties if you're not a sovereign. We also know the Constitution, Article 1, Section 8, mentions Indian tribes specifically, the Commerce Clause. Also, the Article 6, Clause 2, of the Supremacy Clause, as it's called, establishes the Constitution, federal laws made pursuant to it, and the treaties made under its authority constitute the supreme law of the land. So we automatically recognize there that there's a nation-to-nation relationship. Of course, I talk about the Marshall Trilogy, the three Supreme Court cases there. The bottom line, while they took away some power of the tribes to either sell land to private citizens or private citizens to buy land, or identify tribes as a ward to the federal guardian, and various other pieces of laying out relationships between tribes and states and the federal government, the bottom line is that it affirmed the legal and political standing of tribes. Of course, we have several others. The Indian Removal Act of 1830. Most are familiar with that. That's what resulted in the Trail of Tears. And the Choctaw Nation, of course, was the first to make the Trail of Tears in 1832 to what is now southeastern Oklahoma. We gave the president basically the right to negotiate with tribes for removal of land to federal territory west of the Mississippi. Then, of course, I don't think I have it on here, but we go into other aspects like the General Allotment Act, also known as the Dawes Act in the 1887, which took away more sovereign right of land ownership and broke down into individual tribal members and treated those as restricted treaty lands, which then further was diminished, of course, with what people know as the 47 Act or the Stigler Act now. And then it was determined that you can only have sovereign right and reserve treaty lands based on blood quantum. So, you know, there's just been this degradation. And then, of course, in the early years, and then as we moved into citizenship in the 1920s, it looked like things were going to make a little bit of a rebound. And then, of course, the Reorganization Act of the 30s kind of took some away and then gave a little more and things along that line, and along with Public Law 280 in 1953. Determined jurisdictional and criminal cases that happen on Indian lands as related to both tribal and non-tribal members. And of course, those have gone back and forth a number of times. There's a case going right now, the Murphy decision that could impact Public Law 280, as a matter of fact, and it's been almost 70 years since that law was put in place. So Like I said, sovereignty is a moving target at all times. Unfortunately, I wish it was easy to explain and to pinpoint what it is, but it's not. And of course, in the 70s, we had a lot of things that helped strengthen tribal sovereignty and the president and Congress putting things into play that help us today that determine what authority, what jurisdictional pieces we have in the right to self-govern. So basically, the right to self-govern consists of four components. You have to have territory, you have to have a population, you have to have the authority, and you have to have recognition. Because if you're not legitimate, if you don't have reciprocal recognition, if nobody recognizes you as a sovereign, you're not sovereign. I could buy an island and throw a couple people on it and say we're sovereign, but if nobody recognizes that, then what good does it do, right? So the point is that recognition, and of course, here in the United States, we all recognize the federal government, state governments, and tribal governments as separate entities that self-govern. All right. Now we'll get into a little bit of the meat of what I'm really here to talk about and how it relates to natural resources. In the 50s, the United Nations saw that there were countries and indigenous people that were being invaded and their natural resources just ripped away from them and whole communities were being destroyed and lifestyles destroyed. And so they said, you know, we need to do something about this. This is a human rights issue. And so they set out and had a committee that set forth and did a huge study and came out with a resolution that basically said, every human has the right to self-determination, right? And that every single group of people have permanent sovereignty over their natural resources. So their comments in the committee and the UN and the General Assembly, they came out with this resolution. It's Resolution 1803, I believe, and they lined out basically steps and processes in which the recommendations were made to adopt this resolution on the guiding principles of sovereignty. And that's on our national or an international scene, worldwide scene. So, natural resources. If we acknowledge that natural resources exist without actions of humankind, then why does sovereignty matter, right? They're going to be there anyway, right? Well, not necessarily, and that's what we're talking about. So, of course, we depend entirely on a healthy natural environment, right? Our wealth, well-being is all guided towards that. It's the fundamental to our economy, social structures, homes, neighborhoods, the ability to create and construct things. Our health and happiness is driven around our natural resources and nature. So much so that human beings are part of the natural world, right? And we are one species among millions. And so therefore we have to evolve as part of nature and not apart from it. And I hit on a few points here around the requirements where sovereignty comes in as a play and how we see things, especially tribal sovereignty, from a cultural perspective and or from just a human value and moral perspective and the reason why sovereignty matters when it comes to natural resources. Of course, we recognize most natural resources as renewable or non-renewable, right? One or the other. And from a human use perspective, we classify those based on replenishment recovery rates based on consumption, right? So if you consume too much, it's non-renewable, right? If you allow it time and some of these things are, several decades to renew, then it's probably a renewable. But that's where good management practices and things along sustainable practices come into play. Or you end up with the thinking of technology and things that make consumption or use of natural resources easier. And we think we're using less. I believe the Jevons paradox is one of those that defines that. And Kazum Brooks postulate talks around the fake mentality of the more efficient we come in using a natural resource, the less natural resource we use. And in reality, that's not the case. It's, That's economics, environmental economics, has been proven wrong a million times. The more efficient, the more accessible a resource is, the more it will be used. So then it comes down to conservation or preservation, right? So once again, the sovereign and ethical obligation governing right of use, allocation, and protection. So one is determining the proper use, and the other is protection, protecting it from use, right? So it's this weird paradigm of how do we do both and continue to ensure that we live today and into the future. And so it comes down to that. That is the question. How do we avoid depletion and overconsumption or contamination even of even ubiquitous resources and how we treat them going forward? And it all ends up in management, right? So everybody knows those are all a lot of catchphrases that go around, sustainable practices, right? And water management and land use planning and biodiversity conservation. And you know, natural resource management specifically focuses on scientific and technical understanding of the resources and ecology. We focus on life supporting capacity of resources. Sovereignty, on the other hand, empowers and enables us to plan and implement practices, both cultural and I would say self-determination based, that ensure the quality of life for both present and future generations. And we take that very seriously from a tribal perspective, so much so that we put a lot of effort and a lot of resources, personal resources and cultural resources, into protecting and managing and having good best management plans and working with experts on how we move forward on those management plans. So having said all that, I'm going to roll into everybody's favorite topic in Oklahoma other than oil and gas, and that's water. So obviously there's a commitment there with planning, developing, distributing, and managing. And I have a video, some of you may have seen it already. It's from the water settlement between the Choctaw, Chickasaw Nations, and the state of Oklahoma, and some would say the city. If you're not familiar with that, is everyone familiar with the water settlement in the room? So just the short version of it is the city applied for a permit about 6 years ago now, I guess, to pull water from Sardis Lake down in southeastern Oklahoma. And the tribes filed a federal lawsuit based on treaty rights to water. And it started a five-year-long discussion. That's a nice way of putting it. A discussion, a legal battle around who has authority, who has jurisdiction, who has rights to water in Oklahoma. And it involved a lot of science and principles related to water management. It also involved a lot of give and take on all parts. The key, I would say, and the reason why I wanted to show the video, for those of you who haven't seen it, is that the key is everything hinged around sovereignty. Sovereignty of the Chickasaw Nation, the Choctaw Nation, the state, and even the city to some aspect around consumption, you know, consumptive use of water. So the tribes, of course, in the settlement, our concern was around the fact that we had a lot of antiquated data that was being used for permitting processes. And we wanted to ensure that not only were we looking at existing permitted consumptive use, that we were also focusing on the non-consumptive use of water. In our area, we have a number of endangered species. We have a lot of recreation, and you know, to us, that mattered. We didn't want to see that disappear. We wanted to make sure that was protected. So the conversation set out in that way, and in the end, that's exactly what happened. We now have a seat at the table to determine, define, and to utilize a tool that lays out what those numbers are and the impact that future permitting will have on watersheds or the settlement, what we call the settlement basin, which is all of southern Oklahoma. So as you may or may not know, it appears the Osage Nation is about to enter into the same conversation with the state due to their groundwater permitting that they issued one permit already on, and saw Chief Standing Bear's press release, and he was none too happy about the state telling him he wasn't allowed to do that. So, you know, it came back, and we did not argue any points around OWRB, the state Oklahoma Water Resources Board, having the authority to permit water. We agree with that as a nation to nation. But we did want to make sure we protect cultural resources, endangered species, and the non-consumptive recreational use in our water basins. So, and to have better planning tools for how we permit out in the future. So having said that, if I can get this to work, maybe. I have three videos I can show you. One's based on the science comment, the guiding principles, and then this is the general one. I'm going to show this one first, just as a means for everyone to see all of the players that were in the game and the collaborative effort that went into this long-term resolution.
I am so very pleased that after years of work, we have collaborated, we've discussed, we've come together with a solution that works well for everyone.
To finally come together about good lake level management plans, being good stewards of a resource, and to keep it abundant and secure for the future is critical to the success of, again, of our communities, again, for our tribal members, and for the state of Oklahoma.
Well, as Attorney General, I'm very proud to be part of this historic agreement among the state of Oklahoma, the Choctaw and Chickasaw Nations, and Oklahoma City. It's been a great effort by all parties involved, tremendous amount of patience and commitment.
So everybody benefits from this agreement. People who utilize the water for consumptive uses, those who use it for recreation and tourism and the like.
It reflects the best interest of all Oklahomans, and I'm very proud that all parties came together to reach such a solution.
We have forged this agreement based on our common interests and an understanding we all want the same thing, to take care of our vital water resources responsibly.
Having a sufficient, reliable supply of water is essential for life, economic development, manufacturing, recreational activities, and important industries like energy and agriculture, just to name a few.
So as part of the agreement, the state retains its permitting authority over water in the settlement area. And that's important because uniform permitting and administration provides certainty and consistency for the management and use of the state's water resources.
This agreement is definitely a way to secure existing water rights for people that already have those permits. It makes sure that we protect water for the future for our area in southeastern Oklahoma.
We, the Chickasaw and Choctaw Nations, now have a voice in specific proceedings. This is something that we've needed in order to help serve our people and meet the requirements of our jobs. It's so important to all of us.
The agreement fully resolves the state's debt to the federal government for the construction of Sardis Lake, which will ensure Oklahoma City has a firm water supply while providing a standard to protect lake levels in Sardis, which we can all agree is very important.
Tourism is our third largest industry in the state of Oklahoma, so it was critical that we make sure and become unified and make sure and protect this water resource so that we can keep the dollars that's needed to sustain our local economies as well as the entire state of Oklahoma.
Water is a very valuable resource, so the idea of conservation shouldn't be overlooked either. I know in Oklahoma City, we've taken a lot of proactive steps to try and teach our citizens how to use water more wisely. I think it's a step in the right direction.
There are drought contingencies in this agreement, and it's for protection for everybody. For example, in Oklahoma City, before any water can be drawn down from Sardis, they have to make sure and practice good conservation measures. Their lakes have to be at 65%, so we want to make sure that they manage their lake levels very good.
It's only through unity and cooperation that our vital water resources can be preserved, protected.
It's developed a mechanism that will collaboratively address any possible possible out-of-state water uses if out-of-state water use is ever authorized by the legislature. And again, it's currently not authorized. But this new mechanism will provide protections for the source basin and make sure that the region is protected while ensuring the entire state benefits if out-of-state water use is ever authorized.
I would like to applaud the determination, the visionary leadership of the Choctaw and Chickasaw Nations and Oklahoma City. All parties worked tirelessly to reach an agreement that would be fair to everyone.
What is good for our tribal members, what's good for the constituents of Oklahoma City, what's good for Oklahoma citizens. We're all Oklahomans at the end of the day, and we wanted to make sure that we did what was best for everybody as a whole.
Well, personally, I have great respect for everyone involved in these negotiations, from the progressive leadership of the Chickasaw and Choctaw Nations to the state of Oklahoma. And certainly I'm proud of the way Oklahoma City got involved, and we all worked together for the betterment of the state of Oklahoma.
Everyone came together in this process with an intent on finding a resolution. It wasn't about adversity, it was about working together to meet the needs of all Oklahomans.
This agreement is historic. The bringing together of Oklahoma City and the state of Oklahoma and these tribes is so important for the future of the state. This has been a very important process, one that looks to the future. It's a great agreement.
Well, I'm not going to play the other two videos, but you kind of get the gist of the state leaders there, tribal leaders, and their feeling on the settlement. Of course, like I mentioned, not everybody got everything they wanted, and of course, I know from a tribal perspective, we would have liked a whole lot more. But I'm sure everyone can appreciate several comments that were made in there, that everyone had to do what was best for the state of Oklahoma and the citizens of the state. It is promising, though, to know that in the agreement and in the act that was passed in Congress, that there is the language, and we've spent a lot of time in conformance going between the language of the settlement agreement and the settlement act, and ensuring that the language that governed future permitting was in there, and how the tribes played a role in that, and then the fact that there needed to be a redress on the science that was used to determine flows and permittable water for future use. So that was a very promising piece, and I think is a move in the right direction for both tribes and the state of Oklahoma. And we have a lot of work to get there, obviously, but because a lot of that data does not exist currently. So, but I have faith that we will get there, and I know the tribes will be leaders in that, and because it matters to us. So we will play a larger role in that. So moving on from water, I hit on sustainable agriculture a little bit, and of course most people in this room, I don't need to read any of this to. And you know, it's hard to convince some people in the state to try new things and to try, especially when agriculture is so large and predominant in our area, to get them to think out of the way that their grandfather or his grandfather and 3-4 generations back did things. And we've all seen things come and go. Peanuts is one of those, cotton is another, and so on and so forth. And so, as we look at a true holistic view of our area, we see ways that sustainable agriculture plays a key role in the future generations, meeting needs of future generations, but we also understand the fact that we have an obligation to do things like soil health and soil health projects. And fortunately for us, we've had a lot of attention in our area from NRCS and focusing on soil health projects and demonstrations, so that we don't just say it to a producer, we can show them the benefits of those projects and using cover crops and preventing erosion know, one of the things that proved out really well for us is a few years back when we had multi-year flooding events, the Red River, all of our properties were impacted significantly. And we had a lot of, not just a lot of damage from infrastructure and structural damage, but also from a disease standpoint and a number of other pieces. One of our predominant agriculture businesses is pecans. And of course, most of you know pecans stay under water for very long. They're impacted. So, you know, we had a lot of work to do there and a lot of negative impact that we were able to go in and do a lot of reclamation on and try to put sustainable practices in place that would prevent those type of impacts from happening in the future. So, very proud of us for doing that. And the beauty of it is, as Elizabeth mentioned earlier, when I was asked the question about what do we do things just for tribal members or you know this and that, and I said yes, it's because we do take a community-based approach. And when we hold demonstration events or we hold our community events, we don't just invite tribal members, we invite communities as a whole, because we know we can have a bigger impact if we're touching everyone as opposed to just a handful of people. So, you know, we do have a large presence, obviously, from a tribal member standpoint, and they are the predominant group of people that attend our sessions and training sessions and things, but we make sure we approach it as a community, as a whole project. The same goes with our youth agriculture programs, our livestock shows, and things along that line. So, you know, we're very proud of that. Land use planning. We obviously know that poor land use planning can have a significant impact on ecosystems, and it even compromises sovereignty to some point. I like to point out, you know, some things related to people that go out and destroy wetlands and put and they don't do the proper permitting or mitigation, and we talked about earlier at the center the American burying beetle and some endangered species pieces and how we impact. We don't do proper land use planning, and we don't do the right steps, and we don't go in and make sure what the impact to the entire ecosystem is in that area, and we just go and do. It really is. We've seen it a number of times. It's devastating. So what we try to do is develop integrated land use management strategies, and then action plans around those. Have step-by-step pieces that ensure that there's no compromise of our sovereignty for lack of permitting purposes or lack of you know doing things the wrong way and having them come back on us. So and I said, where do you start? And it's there's a lot of words on there, and it's really just goes into the step-by-step process of what we do on our land use planning and how we look at everything before we move in. We've even started implementing these practices on properties before we purchase them. So we're doing all these assessments and saying, what is the best use of this property? What is the impact that we're going to have if we go in there and put a travel plaza? What is the impact we're going to have if we use it as an agriculture property? Will it impact a riparian area? What is the issue here? And making sure that we're not just buying property just to buy it, to own it, and it's set there and go fallow or something like that. We're actually using the property for its best intended use. It's something we just implemented this last year. It's had a huge impact already on a lot of the properties that we currently own and that we were in the process of purchasing. So I'm going to wrap it up, and I'm going to make a statement. I wrote something down here, and I'm going to kind of read it off. And I believe this in my heart. Just from my experience as a Choctaw tribal member, my family's generational passing down of things and having a big role in, from an agriculture and natural resources standpoint, of working with our cultural preservation groups, our historical preservation teams and staffs, and doing, some of them have done decade-long research on different pieces of pre-trail tiers lifestyle as opposed to Indian territory lifestyle, and even now in our current era, the differences. And, We've come up with a lot of interesting things, and we've gotten away from a lot of great practices that were sustainable practices, and because they weren't easy or they weren't cost efficient. And now we see ourselves kind of crawling back into that space and saying maybe we should do these things, because what doesn't cost us a dollar today costs us $1 million tomorrow, right? So we've been looking at a lot of those practices and seeing where we can implement them again and have a big impact on our tribal-owned lands as well as tribal member-owned lands. And one that just comes right to mind is I manage a program that we do invasive species management, right? Predominantly, it's feral hogs currently, because that's our biggest impact. In other areas in the state, eastern red seeker is a major problem, but our area is feral hogs. Well, we have feral hogs impact wildlife populations. They destroy property. They impact your water table. I mean, it's just bad, right? They're bad. So we realized early on that managing feral hog issues on our own properties was not going to solve the problem, right? Because we get all the hogs off our property, the hogs in the surrounding properties come onto our property, right? So we approached the Bureau of Indian Affairs under their invasive species program, came up with a multi-year plan of how we can have a bigger impact, once again, on a community of producers or landowners, as opposed to just being the tribal lands. And a very lengthy document we put together that we fortunately had great success in obtaining funding from them on, and we've developed a system in which we go out and do a lot of community events, and we go out and help producers and landowners in capturing, or even they can self-capture. We've even worked with the Department of Wildlife, the Oklahoma Department of Wildlife, on the permitting processes for transporting, and some of those laws have changed, if you're not aware of that. And, making sure that we can have a larger impact in our area on that issue, and we have. I think I was telling someone earlier, the last 2 years, on one property alone, one of our largest properties, we've caught over 1,500 feral hogs. It's just one property. So the fun part for us was that we actually started thinking around the research end of things and said, you know what, it's nice that we're catching them and we're, you know, we're doing something with them, we're giving them away as food items or whatever the case may be, but why aren't we tracking this? Why aren't we doing some data and tracking this? And so we did. We developed an app, and what this app does is it allows us to, we GIS every sounder that we catch, we take pictures. Once we terminate the animal, we weigh them. We put all the documentation in there, we age them, weigh them, that type of thing. And then that information is available to our counterpart at BIA in DC. So they can see what we're doing at any given time. It also helped us, because then we got the opportunity to quit doing reports and sending them up to BIA, because they could go on at any time and see what we were accomplishing. So it's been a great success, and we've had a lot of the participation from community members that have been inundated with hogs. And you know, a lot of people think they're really smart, and they are. They're smart. They're not crow smart, but they're smart. But they're also catchable. So in my closing comment, I just wanted to bring up the fact that the unique aspect and history of indigenous knowledge of ecological zones, natural resources, agriculture, aquaculture, forest and game management offers a model for development that is both ecologically and socially sound. Our sovereignty provides the vehicle needed to utilize these important advantages in decision making and provides for participatory approaches to sustainable resource use and development. And I say that because, as you can see in the state of the way things are going in Oklahoma currently, the tribes are having a little larger seat at the table in how we move forward in legislation, how we move forward in management and practices related to water and land and things along that line. So I think that the important piece for us is not only that we're talking about future generations, but we're also taking into historical and cultural practices and being intentional around what those mean to us as a people, and then also what they will mean for generations to come. And to me, and much like language, that's true sovereignty. When 100 years from now, somebody else is standing up here talking about all the wonderful things that we did for the last 100 years that helped maintain sovereignty. That's the real impact.